May I now present to this convocation the candidate for the Doctorate Honors Causa to be conferred by York University, Ray Kurzweil. Ray Kurzweil is an American author, inventor, futurist, and director of engineering at Google. He's been described as a restless genius by the Wall Street Journal and the ultimate thinking machine by Forbes. He has authored 7 books, 5 of which have been national bestsellers. For example, The Age of Spiritual Machines has been translated into 9 languages and was #1 best-selling book on Amazon in science. But of most relevance to York University is the amazing role he has played in supporting students with disabilities through his software and character recognition equipment. As an early pioneer in information technology and computers, Mr. Kurzweil developed the first OmniFont optical character recognition system. Now, this is a computer program capable of recognizing text written in a whole range of fonts. To achieve this, he had to invent 2 enabling technologies. One is the CCD flatbed scanner, and the second was text-to-speech synthesizer. Then he produced products, including the Kurzweil 1000, a text-to-speech converter software program, then the 300 program, which is a multifaceted electronic learning system that helps with reading, writing, and study skills, and the blind reader, a pocket-sized device consisting of a digital camera and computer that scans text through the digital camera images and then reads the text aloud. Mr. Kurzweil has received numerous honors, including 3 from U.S. presidents, numerous doctoral degrees and awards. 3 I would mention: the National Medal of Technology in 1999. This is the highest award that the President of the United States can bestow for pioneering new technologies. 2nd was his induction to the National Inventors Hall of Fame in 2002 for inventing the Kurzweil reading machine. And finally, the Arthur C. Clarke Lifetime Achievement Award in 2009 for his achievement as an inventor and futurist in computer-based technology. Mr. Kurzweil has had a significant impact on society, and through his inventions, he has provided those with visual disabilities the opportunity and the independence to pursue education and normal, bright lives. This has in no small way contributed to opening up York University to a significant constituency of students living with disabilities. For these contributions to society and education, he is exceptionally deserving of an honorary degree from York University.
By the authority vested in me by the Senate of York University, I hereby confer on you the degree of Doctor of Laws Honoris Causa, admitto te ad gradum.
Now it's my pleasure to invite Dr. Kurzweil to address convocation.
Great to be here. Congratulations. It's a great milestone that you've achieved. And congratulations to all of you who've provided the support and encouragement and inspiration for your children, grandchildren, nieces and nephews, brothers and sisters, to get to this point. Let me share with you a little bit of my story and a couple of lessons I've learned. I decided I would become an inventor when I was five. My parents gave me all these enrichment toys. I knew they were enrichment toys because they had lots of little pieces in them, and I took them all apart, and I made this big inventory of little pieces, and then I would go through the neighborhood, bring back broken radios and broken bicycles, and take them apart and add to my inventory. This was an era where you would allow a five-year-old to go through the neighborhood and do this. And I had this idea that if I could just figure out how to put these things together, I could create transcendent effects. I didn't have that vocabulary when I was five. I came up with that word a couple of years ago. But I did have this feeling that if I had the right way of putting them together, I could create sort of magical effects. And that's true of technology. And unlike parlor magic, if you actually figure out how the magic works, the magic doesn't go away. To fast forward to 1981, I realized that the key to being successful as an inventor was timing. The inventors whose names you recognize, like my new boss, Larry Page, it's actually my first job for a company I didn't start, they were in the right place with the right idea at the right time. And timing is very critical. And so I tried to imagine what can we anticipate about the future, because I could see even in 81 that the world would be a different place by the time I finished my project. And that's even more true today. There's been a fantastic acceleration in the pace of technology. Our first invention, spoken language, so I could warn you not to go behind that rock because there's a predator there. That took hundreds of thousands of years to evolve. We then saw that stories were drifting from storyteller to storyteller, so we wanted to make a permanent record. So we invented written language. That went a lot faster. That only took tens of thousands of years. We then wanted better ways of producing written language. The printing press took 400 years to reach a mass audience. The telephone took 50 years to reach a quarter of the population in the United States, Canada, and Europe. Cell phone did that in 7 years. Recently, social networks, wikis, blogs took 3 years. I mean, think back 4 years ago, people were not using social networks like Facebook, wikis like Wikipedia, blogs. It sounds like ancient history. It wasn't so long ago. So your projects, your idea has to make sense for the world that will exist when you finish the project, and it will be a completely different world. And I accepted the common wisdom that you cannot predict the future. But being an engineer, I thought if I gather a lot of data, use the right visualization tools, squinted at the visualizations, maybe I could make some educated guesses. And I made a startling discovery that the fundamental measures of information technology, like price, performance, and capacity, are very predictable. For example, in computation, it's been a very smooth trajectory since the 1890 American census, the first to be automated. And what that trajectory is it's exponential and not linear. And linear anticipation is our intuition. That's hardwired in our brains. So 10,000 years ago, you know, I'm tracking that animal. Okay, it's going this way, and I'm coming up the path this way. We're going to meet up at that rock. I think I'll go a different way. That became good for survival. That became hardwired in our brains. If you actually wonder why do I have a brain, it's for that reason, to be able to predict the future. But these built-in predictors are linear, whereas the reality, not of everything, but of these basic measures of information technology are exponential. And it's a profound difference. If I take 30 steps linearly, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I get to 30. If I take 30 steps exponentially, 2, 4, 8, 16, that's the reality of information technology, get to a billion. The cell phone I'm wearing is several billion times more powerful per constant dollar than the computers I used when I was an undergraduate, and we'll do that again in the next 25 years. And it's not just computers and communication devices. All of biology now is becoming information technology. Physical things with three-dimensional printing is becoming an information technology. So you really need to anticipate where these technologies will be. That's one key lesson. But let me share a couple more lessons with you. One is the power of metaphor, and the other is the importance of courage. So think about the most important discovery in biology, which was the origin of species that Darwin published as a book. Where did he get this idea? You actually most often will not get a key idea from the same field, because other people in your field are thinking about it, and if it was easy to see, other people would have thought about it. He got this idea for the whole origin of biology, evolution, from geology. 20 years before the publication of that book, there was a geologist, Lyell, and he was trying to explain where did these big canyons, like the Grand Canyon, come from. And he noticed that there was little trickles of water at the bottom of each of these canyons. And he said, well, the water has carved out these great canyons of rock. And people thought that was ridiculous. How can a little trickle of water carve out these massive amounts of rock? So it was ridiculed, but over a 15-year period, geologists did the math, and yeah, a few molecules a second multiplied by a million years. Yeah, it makes sense. And it became the established orthodoxy 15 years later. And at the beginning of Origin of Species, Darwin says he took this metaphor, this analogy from geology, and saw that, okay, little trickle of inherited changes from one generation to another over 100,000 generations would carve out a new species. And he got this idea for biological evolution from geology. Einstein was the same thing. He had these thought experiments, which were borrowed from the idea of just walking around or traveling. And you might think that you need an advanced math degree to understand Einstein's thought experiments that led to special relativity, but it's actually fifth grade math. I describe it in my latest book. You can definitely follow these experiments, and it led to this idea of special relativity. And both of these examples also speak to the other lesson of courage. Because Darwin came to these conclusions, other biologists had similar thoughts but abandoned it because the results were so contrary to the common belief that there was some grand designer who had designed all these species. That was the common belief at the time. Darwin's conclusion is that your pet dog is your cousin, millionth cousin perhaps. The elm tree in the backyard is your cousin too, billionth cousin. We're all part of a tree of life. This seemed to argue against the special nature of human beings, that we were sort of sacredly designed separate from the rest of creation, and it was very heavily attacked. The key to his genius is the courage he had to not fall off the horse, to stick with the results of his thought experiments. The same thing with Einstein, these very simple thought experiments. He's trying to explain the Michelson-Morley experiments. Other physicists had followed some similar lines of thought, but the results were so ridiculous that your size and shape and the passage of time changes depending on how fast you're going relative to another person. It seemed ridiculous, but he stuck to his thought experiments. He had confidence and courage to stick with them, and of course revolutionized physics. These are two lessons that I think are worth thinking about. Look for the solution to your problems, not necessarily where everyone else has been looking, but it may be in a radically different field. And have confidence in your thoughts, because it's only the powers of ideas that can change the world. And finally, one last thought is the tools of changing the world are in everybody's hands. I started my first company, major company, in 74. Today that's Nuance. We needed a computer. It cost $100,000. The sum total of high-tech venture capital in the United States in 1974 was $10 million. So we needed 1% of all the high-tech venture capital in the country to buy this computer. And that computer is actually several thousand times less powerful than your cell phone today. But that was the state of the art then. We needed it. It wasn't easy to get these kinds of tools. Today, you know, a couple of kids in a college dorm with their notebook computers created Google, and another kid, undergraduate, in a college dorm with his notebook computer started Facebook. And it's not just 20-somethings. Recently, a 14-year-old using biological technologies came up with an effective early detection test for pancreatic cancer, and that's really what's needed because pancreatic cancer is not that aggressive. The problem is it's not discovered until it's metastasized. So he's found a way to actually detect it easily with a simple blood test, and it's now being adopted. He won the Intel Science Talent Search recently, but he's 15 when he finished the project. So we really have the tools now. A kid in Africa with a smartphone has access to more information than the President of the United States or Prime Minister of Canada had 15 years ago. These are very powerful tools. All you need is the right idea, and which you can get through metaphor and the courage to stick to your thinking. So congratulations and good luck as you explore this remarkable future we have ahead of us. Thank you.